on tap there. We are going live. This is the Greater Grace Church service for Greater Grace Chester and Ellesmere Port. Welcome tonight. I'm afraid we're not going to do live worship, but we are going to have live Word of God, the living Word of God. That's the most important thing. And also fellowship, because that's the thing that we're missing at this point in time, that actually we want to be together, if we can be together, and have life in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the most crucial thing for this season. Now, we have to tell you that tonight we're actually coming from the location of our living room. So last time it was the dining room. So we're going to be going to all sorts of different locations while we're in lockdown. And just be praying for us now. Pray for the technology. Today is actually Greater Grace World Outreach's Ministries Day of Prayer, because it's the first Wednesday of the month and it's also the first of the month. But actually, we've heard that there is a worldwide day of prayer today for the coronavirus. So we're going to start with a little time of prayer. We always do that anyway, but just because we want to join. And maybe after we finish our broadcast tonight, please feel free to continue praying and continue to minister in the spirit of love and really lift people up this season, because it is very key for us. Hopefully you're able to hear me okay, and there are no issues like that this week. Apologies for any technical difficulties we've had over the last few days. But let's pray now and let's give this whole time to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord. We praise you. We want to worship you now. We want to lift up the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour, our Redeemer. We want to lift up the one who is above every other name, the Sovereign God, the Living God, the Mighty God, the Redeemer. And Lord, we just want to give to you the glory that and the honour that is due to your name tonight. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you, Lord, that you take interest in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that the God of the whole world saw fit to send his Son into this world, and that you loved each one of us enough to go to the cross. Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. We think of the troubled times that maybe we find ourselves in as this world and as your people. But Lord, we know that we are the people who do not fear. Though the earth be destroyed, actually we have a God who is with us. Though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we fear no evil. And Lord, we trust you every step of the way. We want to lift up our nation tonight, Lord, and many nations around the world. We want to join with those who are praying today, whether it's in China, whether it's in Italy, whether it's in the United States, wherever people are praying today, Uganda, Argentina, Finland, our friends around the world, Lord, we want to lift up each one. Switzerland, our dear friends in Switzerland, be with them tonight. We want to pray particularly for Priscilla and Litty at this time, and lift them up as their grandmother went into eternity. She was a believer, and we rejoice in that. But Lord, we just want to lift them up as well in this season. We pray for Sarah Winslow as well, and we pray, Lord, that you touch and protect as the due date for her child to be born is today, Lord. And we want to lift her up in your loving arms, in your gentleness. And we just say, Lord, be with Sarah and Phil and the whole family, Sandrine, Pastor Mark, Joshua, each one, their whole family, Lord, now. Protect each one, Lord, now there, we ask. And give a special blessing for this season, Lord. Touch any of us, Lord, that need your special touch. We think of Louise Bingham and Rob, who is in the hospital. Lord, we pray that you'd be with him tonight as well, and that you would touch and heal and restore them, Lord. That you do miracles for them, Lord. And for any others, Lord, we think of Margaret, that you give a peace of mind, Lord. Protect Ruby and Myrtle, Mary Clay, and just each one, Lord, now be with them. Any others that have issues as well, we pray that you'd be with them this season and protect anyone. Be with Janet as well, Lord, we pray that you'd fully restore her as well and just encourage tonight, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you've made us part of a worldwide ministry. And thank you, Lord, that actually we can join in prayer to a God who hears prayer, to a God who makes a difference, to a God who answers. Lord, we lift up as well the decision makers in our nation tonight. And we pray for good decisions, godly decisions. Lord, as we see a country which is in lockdown, maybe in fear, maybe in chaos in many ways. Lord, we trust you beyond everything else, Lord. And we look to you for guidance. And we look to you for truth. And we look to you for comfort. And we trust you for healing. But Lord, we know that true healing doesn't come without the nation turning to you, Lord. And we ask that people would turn to you. They would ask you. They would seek you while you may be found. Fill us tonight with your spirit. With your spirit of truth, your spirit of life. Anoint, Lord, we pray, as we open your word together. Lord, we want to be touched by you, Lord. We want you to be guided by you. And we want to see things from your word that challenge us and that transform our lives. Fill us tonight, Lord. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, tonight, let's turn, first of all, if you have a Bible, and even if you don't, listen on, but we're going to read from Psalm 113, and we'll do verses 4 to 8. So, verse 4, Psalm 113, says, "The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like unto the Lord our God, who dwelleth on high, who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? He raiseth up the poor out of the dust, and lifteth the needy out of the dunghill, that he may set him with princes, even with the princes of his people." Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for these words tonight, Lord. Renew us, fill us, give us your truth, show us your glory. Fill us with your spirit and anoint every thought now, we ask in Jesus' name, for his sake. Amen. Wow. As we have an International Day of Prayer, you know, think about this. It would be no good having a day of prayer if our prayers are just going as far as the ceiling, if our prayers are just nice words. Sometimes we see prayers maybe on the TV, in a very traditional church, and they're very nicely spoken, very eloquently written. But we have the chance to have a prayer of passion, a prayer from the heart, a prayer of reality, and a prayer that moves heaven and earth. And just think of this tonight. We are in the presence of the living God. That's an amazing thing. That is a beautiful thing. thinking about this, the whole situation we find ourselves in with the virus, coronavirus, about, and people living in fear and trembling, insecurity. But one thing I've noticed is that actually people have also become much more thankful than they have ever been before. Thankful for simple things. You know, as we have this day of prayer today, just thanking God that we're alive is actually an amazing thought for every one of us. If we are alive today, that's by God's grace. We don't take that for granted. There are many people who woke up this morning who maybe are not alive anymore. Sadly, they've passed into eternity. But for those of us who are breathing, those of us who are able to breathe well, those of us that have health, you know, be thankful to God, be grateful to God. This is an exciting time in many ways, when actually we can be thankful for the smallest things, that we can walk, that we can have, that we have a place to live, that we have family, even though our family may be very far away for some of us, or maybe we don't see them very often. But people are now thankful for family in a way that maybe they never were before. You know, you think about this, how often we hear people complain about families. You know, you go to your work colleagues and they're grumbling about their husband, their wife, their, you know, their kids, their grandma, and all of these things. And suddenly, because of the coronavirus, people are thankful. Thankful that their loved ones are safe. And in many ways, you know, if we enter into a more thankful society after this, that is no bad effect of this crisis. Because we've had a society based on two things, capitalism and hedonism. You know, I buy, I want, I consume, I get as much as I can. My life is based on how much I have, how good I am at my job, how much money I can earn. These things, this is what is being valued by people. Suddenly none of that matters anymore. Hedonism, how much I can party, what I can enjoy, the enjoyments I get out of life, going out, going here, traveling here, going places, meeting people and doing things. This was the focus of our society, how much you can do. Take a photograph of it, take a selfie here. What did I do today? What did I eat today? Put a picture of it on Facebook. Put a picture of it on the internet, on Instagram. And it's like, no, actually, suddenly God has us in a situation where we can't go out. We can't go to have these amazing experiences anymore. But actually, we can still have an amazing experience with the Lord Jesus Christ. God says, hey, what is really important in this season of life? Is it the concerts, the airline tickets? Is it the holiday? Is it the fake tan? Or is it actually the fact that we're still alive? What is really important? Do we have food in the cupboard? Suddenly that's an important thing. I made a spaghetti bolognese yesterday, and I remember thinking, I don't remember a last time I was so excited to have the actually basic ingredients for a spaghetti bolognese, because we couldn't get them for a few weeks. There was no spaghetti, no pasta in the shops. There was no mince meat in the shops. And you're thinking, it's silly, isn't it, that, you know, things that maybe we took for granted, oh, that's just what we have when we can't think of anything else to eat. Suddenly now, wow, the fact that we have simple food to eat is a blessing. And it becomes real to us. And a shift in the value systems of society that has come through this is quite eye-opening. Tonight our subject is this, taken from Psalm 113. Who is like the Lord our God? There are many gods. If you go onto the street and say, hey, I'd like to tell you about my God, very often the response is, well, which God? Because there are so many gods. Are you going to tell me about Thor or Allah or Venus? Or are you going to tell me about Brahma or Vishnu or which God? There are so many. How can you expect me to believe in a God when there are so many of them? But you know what? The Bible says, who is like our God? And those verses that we read, who is like unto our God, who dwelleth on high, who humbleth himself. Wow. You know, that is the difference. That is one of the key differences to the God of the Bible and other gods. Most religions and most gods are about how high, how mighty, how absolute, how holy, how powerful, how above everyone else their God is. And man has to desperately try to attain, to get somewhere, to climb up, to do things and to be a little bit like the God that they worship. But for the Christian, we have a God who says, no, I humble myself. Yes, maybe I am an all-powerful God. Yes, maybe I could have the power of life and death for any one of you. But I humble myself. That is the God that we worship today. It's unique. In the story of gods, that a god says, no, I humble myself. I choose to lay aside my majesty, my power, my might. I choose to become weak so that I can minister to people who have weaknesses, so that people can relate to who I am, so I can meet them where they're at. The Lord Jesus Christ humbled himself to come down to the earth. The Lord Jesus Christ humbled himself to go to the cross. The Lord Jesus Christ humbled himself to say, actually, no, these people are worth something. They're actually worth my life. I will give my life for them. That is a great act of humility. It's a great act of power as well. But such humility we don't see anywhere else. But it's interesting here, because in this psalm it says, he humbles himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth. You know what? Our God actually, we think of him, yes, he's a humble God. He came down to the earth. He walked amongst his creation. He loved us. He wept with us. He laughed with us. He ate with us. He ate and drank with sinners. He met with people who, he touched the leper. We were saying today about this idea of coronavirus, that you have to stand on the doorstep and not touch people. You know, it reminds us of the fact that in biblical times there was leprosy. No one would touch. This sense of touch was forbidden. But the Lord Jesus Christ, he touched the leper. He did things that actually showed himself to be incredibly humble, incredibly bold, courageous, and powerful. But he humbled himself to be on the earth. But actually, the God who he was so mighty, so powerful, that actually, even for him to look on heaven, even for him to just regard the things of heaven, was still God humbling himself. That's who he was. There's no God like him. There is none like him. There is none in heaven and earth that is like our God. This is the incredible thing. That actually not just humbling himself for the earth, but actually even the fact that he was in heaven was humility for him. Now think about this as well. There's a verse that probably many of you who know God's word are thinking of at this time when we are on this subject of who is like the Lord. And that's in Micah chapter 7. And in verse 18 it says, "Who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger for ever, because he delighteth in mercy. He will turn again, and he will have compassion on us. He will subdue our iniquities, and thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea." Wow. Now, for those of us in Greater Grace Ministry, we remember those verses partly because of the song that Dr. Stevens wrote all those years ago about forgiven, forgotten, and gone forever, where he talks about our sins being cast into the deepest, deepest sea. And that's a beautiful thought for each one of us. That's a great truth that we never want to lose sight of. But you know what? Who is like our God? Who pardons sin and iniquity? Who goes past things? The God who forgives, Psalm 99. This is who our God is. The God of grace, the God of all grace, the God of mercy, the Father of mercies. This is who our God is. He knows what we're like. He knows we'll fail. He knows everything we've done in our life. And he knows our potential to do bad tomorrow. But you know what? He still has mercy. He still has truth. He still is a God of grace towards each one of us. And God's meekness is such that he has the power to destroy us. He has the power to wipe out any one of us. He has the right to judge us. Wow. Think about that for a minute. We don't often like to think about that, but actually God has perfect rights to judge us. He's perfectly holy. And he made us. And he gave us commandments. We broke those commandments. And we failed him. And he gave us a perfect standard. We don't meet up to his perfect standard. And he has, if anyone has the right to judge, it is our God, because he made us. We are his. You know, it's like we can do what we like with our own property, can't we? If we want to give something away to someone, if we want to break something we have, you know, in a fit of temper, we can do that. If we want to sell something that's ours, we can do that. Because we are made by God, actually he has the right to do with us what he likes. But because of his great meekness and his great mercy, he doesn't. He deals with us gently. And he deals with us in love and grace. And he deals with us so mercifully. Because that's who he is. That's his character. That's his nature. Who is like the Lord? Who is like unto thee that pardons iniquity and passes the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? Retaineth not his anger. Wow. Have we ever retained our anger? Have we ever gone to bed angry and got up the next morning? morning, and this thing that made us angry is still there. And, you know, it's like it's there, and we don't let go of it, and we don't forget it. The Word of God tells us, let not the sun go down on your wrath. But you know what? It says, more importantly, that actually God does not retain his anger. That's not who he is. He's the God who forgives. He's the God who restores. You know, he's cast all of our sins into the depths of the sea. The Lord Jesus Christ went to the cross of Calvary. And if we trust him as our Saviour, our cross, our sins were laid upon his cross. They died with him, and they were buried with him, and they're gone forever. And the Lord Jesus Christ, raised in resurrection life, gives us newness of life, gives us a fresh start, gives us something to be excited about. That actually we can be raised in newness of life, and the old things can be passed away and gone forever, just like those sins lying at the bottom of the sea. Once something's in the sea, there's not much chance of us getting it back, is there? Is there? I heard about somebody who some of you may know, who lost their wedding ring on a beach. Sad story. But what happens when the tide comes in and whatever is on the beach is washed out to sea? The chances of finding what's dropped in the sea again are very slim. But actually for us, our sins are cast into the depths of the sea. They're gone. They're gone forever. You know, another favourite psalm of mine is Psalm 103. And just, it says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. And when we're talking about thankfulness, that again is another key thing, to not forget all of his benefits. Because again, we're focused on who he is, the God who we have, and how he is different from everyone else and every other God, who forgiveth all thy iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. Wow. Again, great words, great promises, great revelation of who our God is and what he is like. What's his character? What is he doing for us in this life? Yeah, he forgives all our iniquities, the things that we've done wrong that maybe we didn't even intend to do wrong, as well as the things that we've done wrong because we know that we've done them wrong. Actually, the word iniquities in the Hebrew, it has this sense of bending the rules, getting around things. That's one thing I always remember from studying it out years ago, is this idea that, well, you know what, I can get around the rules. I can just bend them. They don't really apply to me. But actually, you know what? God says, no, I can deal with those. And I even forgive those, and heals all our diseases. What a promise in this day and age, that we have a God who says, I will heal your diseases. I will heal what is wrong. I will restore what is wrong. We can go to God for healing. You know what? I will say this now. I have prayed to God in the past, and I have received healing. Miraculous healings in some cases, Now, not everybody who prays gets healed. Not everybody in the Bible always got healed. We're not one of these churches that says, oh, if you, you know, if you're faithful, God will definitely heal you. No. But we can ask. And there is healing. And you know what? God has even used me to heal other people. Again, even at times when I didn't even believe he could do that. You know, he used me to heal other people. And I think, well, you know, I don't believe in these crazy gifts. You know, I believe in God's word. But you know what? If God wants to do it, he will do it. And he's the God who will heal us. We can ask for healing. We can pray for healing. Who healeth all our diseases. And that's the thing. He is able to heal all diseases. Now, it may well be that some things we don't get healed are not because God is not able to, but because maybe he has a plan in us seeking him through the suffering, or maybe he has a plan to use that illness, to use that weakness in our life. Think about this again. Jacob had to be given a weakness for him to submit to God. And so sometimes the things that we think are our major problems could actually be our major blessings. And, you know, just because we don't get healed or something, it doesn't mean to say that God can't do it or he won't, but actually he has a purpose in it. And maybe we just have to seek him, seek his face to find out what the purpose is in these things. Who redeems our life from destruction. Now think about that again for a minute. The God who redeems our life from destruction. Actually, any one of us could face destruction. Any one of us actually maybe even deserves destruction. You think about this as well, and it's something that we've brought up over the years. People say, you know what, well, I'm not a sinner. I haven't done anything wrong. But if you imagine that you did one wrong thing every day, or one or even two wrong things every day, well, hang on a minute, two wrong things every day, 365 days in a year, that's 700. Three wrong things every day, that's about 1,000. And if we do 1,000 wrong things, 1,000 sins every year. If we live for 70 years, 70,000 sins. 80 years, 80,000 sins. Wow, it's no small thing. Actually, any one of us could face destruction and maybe even deserves to face destruction. But God reveals himself in that he redeems us from destruction. He redeems us, he redeems our life from destruction and crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercies. This is who he is. This is who he is in reality. You know, we are able to call on our God. He renews our strength. He satisfies our mouth with good things. Now think about that again for a minute. Maybe we think about that in the food terms. Oh yeah, I like to have my mouth satisfied with good things. That's great, you know, I like to have nice food. And God provides for us in many of these things. But what about this? I have a question, or I have a thought on my heart and something I want to bring to God. Can God satisfy those things from our mouth? Yes, ask him. Bring your petition, bring your question, bring your doubts, your fears, your cares, your worries, anything that comes out of your mouth. Bring it to God and actually he will satisfy our mouth with good things. And his word is full of promises for these good things. He says, you know what? Open your mouth wide and I will fill it in Psalm 81. You know what? Isaiah was a man of unclean lips and he said, and I dwell amongst the people of unclean lips. And yet, guess what? God satisfied his mouth with good things as well. And whatever we have, whatever we need our mouth to be satisfied with, God will give us good things. We trust him. Wow, this is our God. Who is like him? You know what? Let's just do this in closing as well, because we've been on the air for a while now. But Romans chapter 8. On this subject of who is like the Lord. Who is like our God. Romans 8 verse 31. We'll read this again. Well-known verses, and probably you can quote them off by heart, some of you already. It says, what shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, but in all things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Wow. Who is like our God? Who is like him? And he calls us his children. We are his children. Who is like him? Who else can do any of these things? You know, it says that we're reminded of those words that he didn't spare his son for us. He gave us all that he could. He gave us everything he had. He put everything right. He made everything good. He took every responsibility. And who can accuse us now? Who can lay any charge to us? Why? Because of what Jesus has done. Who can actually bring an accusation against God's people? The government? Our boss? Auntie Sheila? Who is it that's going to criticize us? Who is it that's going to judge us? Who can judge us? Actually, no, God justifies us. The Lord Jesus Christ, he's justified us. And actually, he's made it right. And because of that, who else can do anything? Who is like the Lord our God? He humbles himself. Who is like our God? And who else can do anything? And I love that as well. It says those words, who can separate us? Now, there's a list of things there. And the temptation would be to say, well, what can separate us? What can separate us? Because there's all of these lists of things, of, you know, tribulation and distress and persecution. But actually, the word of God doesn't say that. It says, who will separate us? Because you know what? Very often behind all of these things, all of these what's, very often there is a who. And you know, the who can be a kingdom of darkness. The who can be a demonic forces. the who could be a world system, the who could be our own flesh. But there's a bigger who. There's a bigger who in our life. There's who is like our God. And that's what we celebrate tonight. That's who we worship tonight. The God who is unequaled, who is unrivaled, who has power, who has purpose. Who can separate us from his love? A love that goes beyond. A love that is unchanging. A love that is uncompromising. A love that is limitless. This is our God. And I love that, just to go back to where we started. Who is like our God? And, you know, we read those verses, how he raises up the poor out of the dust and lifteth the needy out of the dunghill. And you know what? There are times in our life that maybe we need to be reminded of that. That our God raises up the poor and the needy from the dunghill. You know, wherever we find ourselves in this life and whatever we do, you know, our God is there. And he's there. He's not too high and too mighty to not be able to meet us on the dunghill. He's the God who meets us in the dust. He made us out of the dust. And you know what? The curse on Adam when he sinned was that to dust you will return. And actually, you know what? Naturally, our soul cleaves to the dust, doesn't it? In Psalm 119:25. But actually, you know what? We are more than just dust. God's taken us from the dust. He's taken us from the dunghill. And actually, he's raised us up to great things. He makes us sit together in heavenly places. He makes us part of his family. He's clothed us with new garments. What's his name? Zechariah 3, isn't it? Joshua the high priest was clothed in filthy garments. But he gives us a robe of righteousness, Isaiah 61, as well. Why? Because he's the God of grace. He sets us amongst princes. Wow. You know, only a God of grace can do that. No other God can do that. But the God of all grace can do that. A God of merit can't do that. A God of the law can't do that. A God who is only about justice and righteousness and holiness and nothing else couldn't do that. And there are gods on this earth who people worship who are like that. But the God of all grace, he can do that. This is our God. Who is like the Lord our God? You know, for yourself personally tonight, only you can answer that. If you have the Lord Jesus Christ as your God and as your Saviour, then you have a God that is like no other. If maybe you've never ask the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart, but there's time for that. There's a place for that. Just say, you know what? I need a savior. I need someone to take responsibility for my failures, to forgive my iniquities, to pay a price for me. And I believe that the God who is like no other, a God of mercy, a God of humility, a God of grace, a God who has the ultimate power but has the meekness not to use it, that is the God that I need. That is the God that is set apart, who is different from every other God. That is the God that I desire. Amen. God bless you all. Take care, and hope to see you again soon.